good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I warmly welcome you on this very well cold winter evening to our discussion on the struggle over oil, conflicts, profits, and alternatives. And as you might have seen in the program, the discussion will be held in English, but we have simultaneous interpretation. Channel 3 will be English, Channel 2 will be German. Die Diskussion wird heute auf Englisch geführt, aber Sie können sich immer noch Kopfhörer holen. Es wird simultan Deutsch-Englisch gedolmetscht. Kanal 3 ist Englisch, Kanal 2 ist Deutsch und in der anschließenden Diskussion können Sie Ihre Fragen auch auf Deutsch stellen. So let me first welcome our two international guests, Philippe Billon and Manana Kochladze. Warm welcome. I also welcome Karin Fischer, our moderator, who has programmed today's panel discussion together with me. My name is Martina Neuwirth. I'm working at the VIDC, the Vienna Institute for International Dialogue and Cooperation, and I'm working on international finance and economic issues. My work focus is on international taxation, as some of you might know, and that, of course, also includes the taxation of oil and gas industries. And this is a very, very important issue, of course, for resource-rich countries, as a lot of money is at stake for those countries. Hundreds and hundreds of billions of tax money, of revenues, that can be potentially collected every year. But neither are companies always paying a fair amount of tax and bonus payments, due to illegal tax evasion, legal tax avoidance, or also tax incentives or sugar or sweetheart deals that are offered to them by their host governments. And nor are host governments also always transparent. They often do simply not tell their citizens how they spend the revenues that are coming from the extractive industry. So Gubat Ibadolu from the Economic Research Center in Baku in Azerbaijan already told us at a VIDC panel discussion back in 2013 that oil and gas revenues are supposed to flow into the state budget of Azerbaijan, but 60% of the budget are not disclosed to the budget, so nobody knows where 60% of the oil and gas revenues are going to. So I guess Manana will go more deeply into those kind of problems in her region. Furthermore, family members of President Aliyev participated in foreign oil and gas companies that were active in the country. So we see a close connection of state elites, the presidential family, and the oil and gas sector. But intransparency and corruption are not the only part of a phenomenon that we can call a resource curse. That means that resource-rich countries are not always rich. On the contrary, the domination of the extractive sector can crowd out other sectors and hamper economic development. Rent-seeking elites may fight for dominance, leading to conflicts and wars. And some researchers even argue that oil-rich countries in general tend to be less democratic and more autocratic. So, moreover, what we also should not forget tonight is the environmental problem. So fossil fuels not only add to climate change or contribute to climate change, extraction and transit also cause environmental degradation, of course. So in our last VIDC panel discussions, we looked at the state and its role in a globalized economy. We also looked beyond the borders, that was the title of the discussion, to find new ideas to reconcile economy and ecology. And in April next year, so in a couple of weeks, we will have a closer look at another global player with a particularly strong appetite for resources, and that is China. So today, we are linking up with all those issues, and we look at the role of the oil and the gas sector in our economy, and at the geopolitical implications of the quest for oil and gas. And we might also discuss whether and how we can get out of all these fossil fuel traps. So finally, let me thank my colleagues at the VIDC who helped me to organize this event. And also let me thank our cooperation partner, the Diplomatic Academy, and also our interpreters, Gabriele Gallo and Thomas Musil. Finally, my thanks also goes to the Austrian Development Corporation, who supports this event financially. So our discussion will end at 9 o'clock, about 9 o'clock, and afterwards we are warmly invited to a buffet, a small buffet that will wait for you outside, and so you can go on with your discussions at an informal level. You can also give us a short feedback. You should have a feedback questionnaire, a short questionnaire at your table and at your seat, and we ask you to fill it out and put it in the blue box that you will find outside. So now, finally, let me introduce shortly our moderator, Karin Fischer. She is the head of the Politics and Development Research Department at the Institute of Sociology at Linz University, as well as a consultant to the VIDC. She is the chairwoman of the Mattersburg Circle for Development Studies at Austrian universities. And in 2016, she co-edited the book Rohstoffe und Entwicklung. It's here. Rohstoffe und Entwicklung, aktuelle Auseinandersetzungen im historischen Kontext. This means something like resource and development, current debates in a historic context. You can also find the German translation of a very good article of Philippe Billon in this book. So, Karin, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Our introduction that leads us directly to the main points of our discussion. Before we delve into our topic, let me say that it gives me a great pleasure to welcome all of you and to chair this panel discussion. We are very pleased that you have come in such large numbers. That is really, really good to see. That certainly has to do with the hot topic, but what is a topic without excellent guest speakers? So I'd like to introduce you both, Manana Kochladze and Philippe Le Billon. Did I pronounce it right? Okay, fine. So both traveled long distances, and we are really happy that we have you here tonight. Manana Kochladze comes from Tbilisi, from Georgia. She works at CE Bankwatch. CE stands for Central Eastern Europe, and it is one of the largest NGO and grassroots organizations networks in the region. She works on, or she's responsible for the thematic areas, energy, transport, and international finance, and we heard already how interwoven these areas are. She is the co-founder and the chairwoman of an environmental watchdog group, so to say, Green Alternative, also based in Tbilisi. And she's concerned with energy, or more concretely with the pipeline system, with the pipeline projects, with these huge infrastructure projects in the region since the late 1990s. And she's trained as a biologist, right? And she uses her scientific knowledge to give voice to environmental concerns and to the local population and to social and environmental problems. Philippe Le Billon, he's a professor at the Department of Geography, right, and the Liu Institute for Global Issues at the University of British Columbia. In his research, he focuses on social environmental problems associated with resource exploitation. And amongst his many publications, I want to mention only two books. One is called Oil. Simply Oil, co-authors together with Gavin Bridge, and that appeared in 2012. And more recently, in 2014, a book called War of Plunder, Conflicts, Profits, and the Politics of Resources was published by Hearst and Oxford University Press. And Philippe's work is based on direct field experience, and this is of course true for both of you, over about a decade or even more, and he did extensive field research in many countries from Angola to South Sudan and former Yugoslavia, and this many years experience and engagement with resource-related conflicts make both Manana and Philippe excellent contributors for our hot topic to discuss tonight. Thank you again for coming. Before we start, give me a second to say a word on the organization of the discussion. We have already heard that it stops at 9 o'clock and that we can gather, come together afterwards. We'd like to address three fields or areas. One is the oil and gas network, its actors, the power relations, their interests, and the geopolitical implications associated with these actors and interests, different interests. Secondly, the conflicts on the ground based on your field research, your experiences. And last but not least, possible ways out of the resource dilemma. So what should or could be done in favor of a sustainable and peaceful development. So if you look at the Fortune list of the world's largest companies, which I have here, 6 out of 10 leading firms, leading corporations are oil and gas companies, and followed by another 2 on rank 11 and 12. So my first question goes to Philippe, and I would like to ask him to give us a short introduction to the basics of the sector. So who are the main actors? What are their interests? What are the power relations among them? And above all, who gets what out of this big business? So Philippe, I hand over to you.
Yeah. The mic is on, everybody can hear me. Not quite. Yes, I think it's on now. Okay, good. Again, thank you all for coming. I come from France, but I work in Canada, especially in Western Canada. And if you follow a little bit like Canadian affairs, you know that sometimes Canada comes up in the news in relation to the tar sands, which you probably have heard about. I'll talk a little bit about that. So I'll provide a very quick overview of the oil sector. I suppose if you're here, it's because you're interested about it, but just to make sure that everybody understands what are we talking about. So. We use a lot of energy, at least the privileged part of the population that has the ability to afford a lot of energy. And since you know the beginning of the 20th century, we've been using more and more oil. That transition to what we call the oil age has started essentially in the US and has become very popularized by the use of cars, but also at the time heating. You may remember your parents were using heating oil. Essentially, the age oil has been really, you know, taking over the world since the end of the Second World War. The question is, you know, how long is that going to continue? Under what conditions? Who's going to make money out of this? And who's going to be losing out of the consequences of the oil sector? So this is where I come from. It's a little bit of an exaggeration, but I visit it from time to time, and it's the open bitumen mining sites, and it's a new type of oil sector. It's actually not really digging for oil, it's mining for oil. And you get very little out of it, and it's a very energy intensive process to get out of this. And in many ways, that's what people think the future of the oil is. It's a future that brings about a lot of contribution to climate change, about a third of it at the moment, yet it remains a very practical fuel. All of us, you know, or most of us, I cycle to work, but we go and we use fuel in our daily lives. And it's very difficult to get out of it. Why? In part because we live in a world that has been kind of constructed around it. So many of you, you live in Europe, you have the great advantage of being in cities that have been developed before the age of oil. And as such, the infrastructure is built for people who are on foot, are on horse carriages, or where. And so the density is generally higher, the infrastructure is there, tramways, etc., etc. That's not the case in many parts of the developing world and most of the northern continent, of course. So you know those landscapes, you're familiar with them. So the world is now adding not only a lot more people, but a lot more people who are consuming. Okay, so how many cars were sold in China last year? 22 million, okay? On average, they consume 8 liters per 100 kilometers, so they're not very, very efficient. Government is trying to make an effort, but this is building up like a consumption necessity for quite a long time. Those cars are going to be on the road for 10, 15, 20 years from now. Okay, and so we come to rely more and more on those hard to find oil resources. Some of them are in Canada, as I illustrate. You remember also probably about two decades ago, peak oil was around. People were making bets. The best one at the time was 2006. Conventional peak oil would be there. And there was this idea that we would be running out of reserves. Well, no, the problem, as many people indicated at the time, is maybe we'll not run out of oil, but we'll run out of time to slow down the rate of carbon emissions. And so this is just a map to tell you a little bit like where all these reserves are. So essentially, you'll recognize two countries in dark brown. One will you be familiar with, which is Saudi Arabia, 260 billion barrels of oil. And another one we're less familiar of in the northern part of South America, which is Venezuela. So the two countries are very different. One represents kind of the past, the big conventional oil finds, and one represents the very dirty future of oil. And that very dirty future is essentially very heavy oil, quasi-bitumen. But they have a lot of it. So when OPEC is saying, we've got a lot of reserves out there, they're mixing those two, the kind of relatively clean oil of the past and the very dirty oil of the future. And when we add to the non-OPEC, then you see that kind of little 20% that remains, about two-thirds of it is actually taken by those dirty oils again. Okay? So we have a lot of dirty oil out there, ready to be burned if the price is right. And if the price is right, people are going to do it because they can make money out of it. Okay? So this is the current, the latest assessment of reserves that you can find out of the private sector. And what you noticed is, whoa, this is quite surprising. The United States has the largest reserve. This was published in July of last year. And this is why we have Trump in power, if we make a bit of a shortcut. But in essence, it's selling the dream. It's selling the dream of America is great again. And it's going to be great again because they can have the big V8 cars and they can consume, etc. Why they can do that? Because of dirty oil and new technologies that allow to unlock those reserves, okay, out there. You'll see that Russia is not far behind, hence the idea that they are both competitors and ally somehow. Okay? And in that case, you see that OPEC and non-OPEC reserves are kind of split in half. Very different picture from the previous one. Okay? So what has been the world production so far? If we look back just at when I was born in the mid-60s, well, roughly, we're on track for disaster. We could say it like that. And by 1990, we would have already gone over 100 million barrels a day of consumption. To give you an idea, Austria consumes a quarter of a million, okay? Just to give you a rough idea. But thanks to the oil shock, many people realize, ooh, this is a dangerous, oil is a dangerous thing. It can be actually blocked, it can be expensive, it can be difficult to get. So let's keep it in the sectors where we really need it, transportation. It's hard to replace in transportation, but we can replace it in other sectors. And that was done for electricity, that was done for heating houses, etc., etc. And so since the early 80s, we've been on a slower pace of growth, but nonetheless, it has been maintained. And it has been maintained in part because despite the efficiencies that the world has had, we've had newcomers into the world development and large consumption, in particular China. So from 2000 onwards, we've had Chinese consumption. And the big unknown, of course, now is will Indians in India consume as many cars as we've seen the Chinese consuming recently? It's not going to happen overnight. At the moment, they just consume a little bit more than France or the UK. But we're talking of 1.5, 1.6 billion people, not 60 million. Okay? So this is the big unknown again. So there are disruptions that are coming in, and that's part of the equation of how the sectors work. Many people, I just spent a year where Tesla is based in Palo Alto at Stanford, and there the idea was, well, maybe we're going to see a revolution. We're going to see a revolution in transportation, and that is really what is going to bring the end of oil consumption. I kind of believe it, but I'm also very doubtful. The most serious conservative estimates, still optimistic, think that by 2040, about 15 to 20% of oil consumption could have been redirected towards electric vehicles. So we hope for that in some ways. So where will that leave us? Well, hopefully we'll be able to get out of that nasty curve that we've seen so far, which is to say that more and more oil is being added thanks to the unconventional, the dirty oil, okay? I'll pass on that. Maybe talk about this for just a second. It's not only about new forms of oil, but also where we find those reserves. And of course, the big debate at the moment, for example, is with the Arctic. You know that Russia in the news around the time of Sochi, when it incarcerated 30 people from Greenpeace, it was because of this attempt to stop exploitation in the Arctic. So now let me come back quickly to the oil actors and cast them in a kind of historical configurations. If you look at the first third, if you want, of the age of oil, we are in a configuration where we're still in a colonial world dominated by Western powers who have colonies or manage their own affairs. And in many ways, they are the Western oil companies, and they operate more or less where they want to be operating within the confines of the colonies. By the 1950s, we've got the decolonization process, or let's say many of the protectorates get attenuated. So then the oil companies have to enter into negotiations with the exporter states. The exporter states in the 60s set up their own national companies. They set up their club, which you are hosting here in Vienna with OPEP, of course. And the Western countries respond to it by creating the International Energy Agency. And by the 1990s, what you see is new actors that should have been there from the very beginning coming up. And those are local communities. There is more attention given to local communities by the oil companies, by the domestic governments, and by consumers in consuming countries in particular. Why? It's because the debate about human rights is much stronger. We understand more the impact of the environment on the long term. So suddenly the power relations between actors shifts a little bit between all of these actors that are represented here. So what are the main power relations? Traditionally, we oppose the kind of producer states to the consumer states, but they both need each other. The trade-off is, of course, that when the price is high, it's the producer states that feel like they are gaining. Well, when the price is low, the importer states feel that they are winning, the consumers are winning. So finding the right price is important to keep both parties in line. Okay, and so that's why we have what is called a price band, which used to be between 20 and 25, and at the moment is between 45 and 55. That's what we're heading for this year, apparently. Okay. And then there is a fight over trying to get access to oil. So the international oil companies, as I mentioned, they were pretty much doing what they wanted to do. But that changed, and they had to enter into negotiations with the national oil companies from the 1960s, 1970s onward. But now there is a new type of national oil companies. And that new type of national oil companies are essentially national oil companies that have come out of countries that have become themselves large consumers. So they are not looking for markets, they are looking for reserves and resources, and they're doing that in competition with IOCs. So this is the Sinopec, CNPC, all those Petronas, Petrobras, and all these BRICS IOCs, if you want. And those are very hard competitors because, like the international companies, they're able to mobilize their home government, Beijing or in for example, Brasilia, to negotiate deals for them, okay, in terms of diplomacy, access to financing, etc. So out of this comes generally a modus operandi between those two types of companies, and very often they will try to compete at the time of bidding, but also sometimes get associated. Okay, so when I do interviews, very often it seems more complicated than it seems. It's not US against Chinese companies. It's a consortium of Chinese and American companies against another consortium, maybe of an Indian and a French company. Okay, and they kind of support each other. out of this set of actors, one of the important ones, especially for an audience like this, is civil society organizations. And what they try to bring is a moral and ethical dimensions to the functioning of the oil sector. Knowing where the money is going, with the developmental impact, the environmental impact, and what they do a lot is rely on documenting and shaming the companies and trying to change the system. So among the organizations that I've worked with in the past and collaborated, these organizations are organizations like Global Witness that go and do investigations in country, try to document patterns of corruption, for example, release it to the media, and try to bring about an initiative like the Extractive Industry Transparency Initiative that tries to say how much money is being paid by oil companies to governments in order to hold the governments into account. So now, quickly, very quickly, who gets what? So the first thing to know about who gets what is essentially that who gets the oil. Well, those people who get the oil are essentially the people who can live a relatively privileged life. And in the world, it's about 10%, 15% of the population. You know, not that many are actually having access to the privilege of owning a car. It still is a great luxury, even in China, okay? The second aspect is how much of the oil money do people get? And so at that point, you have to look a little bit at the sharing of the pie, if you want. So if you take a classic scenario for the past decade, where oil was roughly around $100 to make it easy to capture, and you are in a European country that tax fuel in a relatively heavy way, not like in the US, then roughly that's going to be the proportion you will get. It will cost about $20 to get the oil out of the ground. The government that is producing the oil will be able to pocket $33 in order to compensate for the damage done, but generally more importantly to distribute for public services, etc. And the consumer government will get $40. Okay, and the oil company will get only, I could say, $7. Which can still amount to a lot of money. You know, when we're talking about 2008, we're about $42 billion of profit for Exxon. So Mr. Rex Tillerson did a good job that year, but he was by high prices. So that's to give you a rough idea. But those proportions, they vary tremendously across time and across space. Across time, because as you can see on the bottom line, the price of oil varies tremendously, okay? And the lower the price is, the cost will actually stay more or less the same. Of course, when the price of oil is lower, the companies make a lot of efforts to reduce the costs, okay? And generally, the latest study says that roughly 30 cents to the dollar So for each time the dollar, the price of oil goes down by a dollar, they're trying to get about 30 cents of price reduction. And the government, the producing government, will also get less money. Very often the consumer government will try to maintain its tax base, especially because in our countries, people are very cautious about the tax, the budget I observed, etc. So that's to roughly give you an idea. So, yep, and I stop here, thank you.
And I'm good. Is it okay?
Yeah, it's the last one for this series, so I'm good.
Perfect. Thank you, Philippe. Pretty much the same question goes to Manana. So Caucasus is an extremely important region for the gas transports, or gas producing area, so to say. Not to forget the oil in the Caspian Sea. And in the last years, we know huge infrastructure projects were built up, a pipeline system that should bring gas from East Asia, or better, authoritarian Azerbaijan, to Western Europe, where we consume it. And could you tell us a little bit about the actors involved and their interests and the money that absorbs this project? And another question is the gas network different from the oil network?
So maybe I will start. First of all, thanks for this opportunity to speak about the topic, which I really maybe enjoy to speak too much, but this is the work I'm doing from 1997. I'm monitoring the pipelines, which mainly takes the place from the Caspian Sea, which actually holds quite some reserves for the of the oil and gas resources. Only the Azerbaijani oil and gas reserves is about 4% of the all world reserves. So when the and the Baku is not the new oil or gas spot in the world oil map. It starts in 19th century with the Rothschilds and the Nobel, and the first pipeline was constructed was from Baku to Batumi. And so after the Soviet Union, so this was like issue of the very high interest always. Also for the occupation of the South Caucasus by the Soviet troops in 1919-1921, when it's actually get the power over the so full South Caucasus. One of the major driven forces was the Baku oil, because as Philippe just mentioned, this was like driving force for economic development for at least that stage. So when I want to bring a bit more political direction to this, everything what just on the model we just Philippe proposed. So you see now three pipelines. I'm sorry, it's very difficult. From one point and from another point, it's very easy. You have the Baku-Supsa pipeline, the pipeline that connects Baku to the Black Sea, and it's quite small pipeline. It's cost only $1 billion USD that time. Then you have two pipelines going in the same corridor. One of them is the oil pipeline, which calls Baku Tbilisi Ceyhan. It ends in the Turkey, in the Ceyhan Bay. And it's transports up to the 50 million tons of the oil per year. And most of this oil are going to the Europe and Israel. So this is two major points where the consumption of this oil are stay. It's very high quality of the oil should be stressed. It doesn't contain the sulfur like the other Caspian. So this was one of the major, but why it became suddenly political? Because as Philippe mentioned, there is two major superpower with the major super oil reserves, Russia and US, yeah? So, and when the Soviet Union peacefully or not peacefully disrupted, then of course the power relations start to change in this area. We and South Caucasus, which historically represent the territory of the influence by the different power, and the big power, you have Russia, you have Turkey, you have Iran, and not forget about Iran. And then the Western governments that already have been there also gave the interest. So in 1994, directly after the COP in Azerbaijan, where the popular elected president was dismissed, and the guy who replaced him, because he was like first secretary of the Communist Party of the Azerbaijan during the long, long years, he called Gaidar Haliyev. The British Petroleum signed with the Azeri government so-called contract of the century. And this gives US and the EU, because the who knows British, whom the British petroleum represents, it's both, in one day, the US company, in the UK company, yeah? So this gives to the these big the big states to push the interest forward. But we should not forget about the Russia, and this Russia will come all times. So as soon these two pipelines, Baku-Supsa and Baku-Ceyhan pipeline, appeared, Russia considered that its its interests have been pushed out. So So you can see all these projects which related to that particular projects of the Azerbaijan. If you look to the shareholders, you will see that almost all the projects have the same shareholders, except of the last one, and we will speak about that. It's something very... And you have the, except of the oil pipelines, it appears that there is not that enough oil reserves in Azerbaijan that it was predicting in the 90s, but they find out huge gas reserves. And then the story of the, with the oil and the gas starts. But before, I want to share with you one thing, because as you may know, South Caucasus is one of the most unstable region, in the world. It's the Georgia has two ethnic conflicts. It's actually has the war with Russia. There is no diplomatic relation between Georgia and Russia. You have Armenia and Azerbaijan, who are also in the state of the war with each other over the Nagorno-Karabakh region. There is no diplomatic relations. The ceasefire happens, they stop the fire, but all times then is the outburst, especially last 2 years, and it also has some consequences to have some kind of the attachment to the oil. So it's interesting that pipeline security was always the issue of the NGOs, how in this very, very fragile environment, the what the pipelines will bring. And when the VIDC pipeline security was considered, there was one, they come to the conclusion there would be the security zone around the pipeline, which will be inspected by the military forces hired by the British Petroleum. This sounds very, very undemocratic, unhuman rights based. So after a long campaign, there was agreement was reached. VIDC will have unarmed protected guard, and the Azerbaijan, Georgia, and Turkey's official structures will protect the pipelines. But it was this was achieved after the long campaign. It was not gifted in a way. But still, there is the issue which is rising quite lots of the problems on and the conflicts on directly, because the people having their gardens, fields, and they have quite some problems, and there is also some conflicts on the ground. But there is even more bigger problems which we can see. This is the pipeline security in terms of the blasting, which has happened quite often, even more often than is reported by the international media. So the first blasting happens in BTC pipeline when just directly before the war in August between Russia and Georgia. Then in, after the few days, the pipeline was bombed by the Russians, and there was also some kind of the overtaken by Russia, Baku's part of the Baku subsidy in 2015, and then British Petroleum was forced to avoid this overtaking area, because we have so-called borderization process. Russia occupied 20% of the Georgia's territories. They are doing the bordering. So suddenly they also take some pipeline, which they don't know that it was there, but this is how it works. And then we have quite some terrorist attacks, but this was everything this was expected. It's something not really unexpected. The only problem here is that as soon as the blasting happens or an investigation never say who are those terrorists who are attacking these pipelines. For example, in the case of the BTC pipeline first blowing up, the KPP, which is the Turkish Kurdish party, they claim that this was done by them. But then everybody, including the British Petroleum, tried to convince the world that this was the technical problem. Was it technical problem? Was it not technical problem? Who knows? But the problem is that in this very sensitive area where the pipelines, and you will see later the platform where from these oil and gas is coming out, often burst out and having the fire. There is this idea of having even bigger pipeline. This is called Southern Gas Corridor, Southern Air, which is like directly project of the interest of the European Union. It's in the list of these priority projects. It gets the green light from the Commission, and the pipeline will start again in Baku-Sangachal terminal, goes from Azerbaijan, Georgia, Turkey, crosses Greece, Albania, and then will enter in Italy. And everywhere in this area, you will have the conflicts, which we will speak later about when we speak about the ground impacts. But first, I want to bring to you some kind of more fundamental or systemic failing. So this salt energy corridor, TAP-TANAP, how they are calling, this is also one of the issues, just keep in mind. There is the idea that each project is separate. So there is separate gas and oil extraction in the Caspian. Then there you have the one project that brings oil or gas from one point to another point, and then another project starts. They are separating this not just because they don't understand that this is one system, but just to decrease the cost, and because all this pipeline system, just this one pipeline system, will cost around $40 billion. It will bring around, it's supposed to bring 16 billion cubic meter of gas in annually. So looks like very high costs for that amount. But if you will just drop everything by slices, then each cost of the each development will go down. But in general, it's cost how it's cost. And what is more important here, we have been speaking about how they're getting only $7 per oil. But there is also, we need to keep in mind that it's not only their profit which they are getting. There is also so-called subsidies, free money, as the oil companies themselves called, coming from the governments. These are the money which they are getting from the major international financial institutions. And here you can see that the number of the international institutions, including the World Bank, Asian Development Bank, as well as EBRD, already have been given them vast amount of the money to feed this pipeline. So if you look from this 40 million, around 10 billion, about 10% is already funded by the major international financial institutions, including the newly created Asian Infrastructure Bank, which is Chinese-led bank, and then another 4.5 billion is expecting from the same major international financial institution. And this does not include export credit agencies, which will follow for sure this this development. You will have the for sure the OPIC, SACE, I don't know, any company involved in this construction will turn to their own national ECA and ask them the money. And this money, they really call them the free public money.
And make it more concrete, the strategic interest is to bypass Russia and secure.
The strategic interest is to buy the pass. Yeah. But then look, what is the Russia's response? Because we are not leaving. It's not like the EU is just acting and Russia is waiting. The Russia is same time working absolutely almost with the same partners, including the British Petroleum, and trying to develop the alternatives not to lose the European market. So there was like lots of the problems with Turks recently over the Syria, it's overcome. So recently the Gazprom, it was like October 2016, Gazprom and the Turkish state, they agreed to construct Turk Stream, which supposed to bring from Anapa to near to Istanbul 300 million cubic meter of the gas, which again will go to Greece. And then there is also option with Bulgaria. There was already negotiations between Russia and Bulgaria quite a long time ago. In 2014, European Commission managed to stop the contract, but with the newly elected president of Bulgaria, you never know what happens. So things are not only economic. What I try to say is that things are not only economically driven, but it's driven also politically. And what is also interesting, when I was lobbying the World Bank not to finance that amount of the money they already put in the TANAP and bringing what you're doing about the recent agreement between Turkey and Russia. They say, but these pipelines will anyway be constructed, and anyway we need the gas. So why we need, and in the same project document, the first aim of why they are giving the money to Turkey for this, to diversificate the oil gas supply routes to the Europe. So they are agree from the beginning that more pipelines will be constructed in the region, and they don't have this kind of understanding, which we tried, and I will bring in that this creates the problems all along the pipeline, and it does not really bring any type of the wealth to the population who is there. And one more thing, and I'm finishing speaking about the bigger issues. This is like when we will go later about situation and the conflict in the area. Mm-hmm. You remember that the Azerbaijan and Armenia, they are really having the war over the Nagorno-Karabakh. If you look on this chart, you will see that these oil and gas revenues really give them quite big, opportunity to increase their military, strengthen their military, which Armenia could not. And you can think in this case that Russia is always on the side of the Armenia, they will help the Armenia, but no, the Russia is playing very nice game, both with the Azerbaijan and both with Armenia. Both of them have very good relations, and recently, again, Azerbaijan was proposed to be held by the Russia against of Armenia, which increased makes Armenia crazy. But what they can do? They are the only neighbor with them. They are having the good relation is Georgia and Iran. They have the bad relation with the Azerbaijan. They have no relation with Turkey again. So, in this small region where so many political interests are override each other, the intervention which is leading to make one country much more stronger than in another through this oil and gas revenues really creates mm-hmm. the problems also in larger regional way. Okay. I'm speaking too much.
That's fine. So the thing is, there is a lot of money in there, private and public, and from international financial institutions. It recently appeared a CIA Bankwatch report that there are mafia connections, yes, and yes, great difficulties with that. We can speak on that later on, maybe. Issues. Yeah, and your point was also that the fossil fuel money deteriorated the human rights situation. That's what you mentioned in the case of Azerbaijan, and we will speak about that as well, about the conflicts associated with these pipelines. So this would be the next point to address the conflict on the ground emerging from these projects, and later on we will address the geopolitical dimension again. You already mentioned Trump, but Philippe, I would like to ask you about the conflictual situation. You named your book mm-hmm. Wars of Plunder, and resource wars appears very often in your publication. So can you give us examples from your fieldwork where you experienced that and how these multiple forms of violence evolve around resource exploitation?
Okay, and I'll try to be relatively brief so that we have lots yep. of time mm-hmm. for questions, etc. So in short, we've got about five types of relationships between oil and conflicts. I mentioned the peak oil, so the idea is, it was like, okay, there's going to be no oil around, it's going to be a struggle. So for mainstream geopoliticians, like people like Michael Clare, that's the idea, the struggle over the last few resources, a zero-sum game, etc. Then there is a second one, which is a little bit the one you're talking about, which is a much more dirty and form of conflicts, but maybe not as overt, but trying to manipulate local governments, etc. And it's a little bit the return of geopolitics, whereby the territorialities of control for energy corridors, for oil fields, play a role. It's not simply that we're running out of oil, but it's simply that there are some projects that are more profitable than others. There are projects that are essential to running the economy, for example, of Russia, etc. The third one is a little bit the environmental doomsday type of narrative about climate change that say, well, we've got climate change, we're going to have millions and tens of millions of migrants, it's going to be a mess all over the world, etc. So these things kind of perked up a little bit with Darfur. You may remember Darfur 2003. And of course, it popped up again with the crisis in Syria. People were saying, well, look, there was a recurring drought in Syria for a long time. And so that was part of the problem there. So all these are really, I would say, within the realm of maybe a little bit of conspiracy. They're at work, but they're not rarely overt conflicts. Where we really see an everyday relationship that is conflictual and often violent is in the lower part of the slide. So on the right side, you've got what we could call the environmental conflicts. They are often about micro-level attempts to control oil. Okay, so here is an example from for the slides from Nigeria. So all of you have read in the press that in the Niger Delta, they've had recurring patterns of violence. It actually started with an attempt for a secessionist movement to achieve the independence of what was called at the time the Biafra region. Okay, that was put down through a very bloody civil war that killed about a million people, mostly starving to death. But out of that came essentially a new strategy for people on the ground, which was much more a kind of social movement, revendicating, but not using arms. And they did that through most of the 80s and 90s, but that didn't lead anywhere, in part because there was a very tough military government in place. And the companies like Shell and others were not able to influence the government enough, and they were making their profits. So you all know about the Ogoni, I suppose. The Ogoni struggle was very symptomatic of that. The leader, Kensaro Wiwa, was hanged along with seven others. So it would be a little bit like hanging, you know, environmental and community activists. Those things continue to happen. The result of this in the mid-1990s is a number of youth decided that since going and protesting with a sign was very dangerous, you may as well go and simply take an AK-47 and roam the creeks and extract money from the companies, from the local communities sometimes, and kind of run a show that is much more within the narrative of violent opposition to the oil companies and to the government. So there is a kind of low-intensity war that takes mm-hmm. place in the Niger Delta. This type of situation is relatively unheard of. It is partly the case in Nigeria because of the local geography, the strong networks, and that many of the oil companies, they pay those people in order not to rise up on arms, etc. So at the moment, it just resurrected a little bit because the government stopped paying an amnesty payments to the former combatants. Okay, so since June, we've had a little bit more of that. And the last one, which is on the left corner, is so-called the conflict oil. It's a little bit like blood diamonds. You all have heard of this, of course. So conflict oil is simply the financing of armed combatants mm-hmm. through oil money. And it can take many different forms, sometimes very sophisticated. Like, for example, in Colombia, where I do some work, I was there in December, typically the guerrilla would have a lot of difficulty getting oil directly from the company. So what they would do is they would enter into contractual relationships with the municipalities that get royalties from the oil companies. So there are different strategies to do that. But the end result is a little bit the same, is you've got people that are non-state armed groups that are able to sustain. They struggle, sometimes there is a struggle, and sometimes it's simply like benefiting, okay? So those are the most important ones. Now, I think you wanted to ask me about the US administration.
Let's leave that for a later time. So, I mean, I feel urged to ask about policy reform and ways out of this, but before we come to that point, I would like to address Manana again, because I've read that in a paper, or was it when you received the environmental prize, saying that you are the citizens' ears and eyes when monitoring the pipeline projects. So there was obviously a lot of conflict also on the ground in the Caucasus or in Georgia, where you're working on. Yeah. And I think it would be good to hear how these conflicts were. How they evolved and were they resolved or not, and who was involved there, the local population, the fishermen, what was it about? And then at the end, I would say we address the questions of what is possible ways out of this resource dilemma.
So I will also try to be very short and stop me. If you take the Baku-Tbilisi-Ceyhan pipeline, which covers three countries, and in Georgia it was the shortest route, 248 kilometers, this was the most difficult route for the British Petroleum. Why? It was not. It was not the problem in technology was the same, attitude was the same, everything was almost same. But in Georgia there was the more than 200 strikes when the people was the blocking the pipeline construction. There was permanent strikes of the labor they hired during the construction. There was permanently something happening, and the only explanation is that in Azerbaijan, the people have been really very much suppressed by the Azeri internal forces. In Turkey, that time there was quite a better situation with democracy, but you should remember that this pipeline was crossing the areas populated by the Kurds and by Cherkess communities, which has been under the long, long time pressure from the government. So the major outburst of the conflicts happening in Georgia, but it does not mean that there was no conflict in Azerbaijan or in Turkey. We have been witnesses both in Azerbaijan, also in Georgia and also Turkey, lots of the conflicts. The human rights defenders have been getting the death threats, they have been really taken to police, clampdowns, and the things was on very simple things, as the Philippe said. The people usually in the settlements, they may are not so eager about the high political interests, but they are eager about their incomes and the lands that the government together with the British Petroleum takes from them and non-properly compensated was one of the major issue, of course, all along the pipeline. If at the end it comes turns out that in Georgia they paid per hectare three times more than in Azerbaijan and in Turkey, because there was the highest possibility to sue the British Petroleum into the court, taking compliance to the international recourse mechanism. Then you have conflict, the pipeline crossed number of very environmental sensitive areas. It crossed the major water aquifer in Azerbaijan, it crossed the national park in Georgia, and it crossed Ramsar areas in Turkey. And in Georgia, the battle between the environmental groups and the British Petroleum around relocation of, it was not about stopping the pipeline, it was about relocation of the pipeline, was really major issue. Because this Borjomi National Park this is like one of the best scenery of the landscape you can see, but it also is a reserve of the Borjomi mineral water, which is Georgia is exporting now in 56 countries. This is quite a big resource of the our export. It's like around 3% of the Georgia's export, which is quite a high number. So, and Georgia is a poor country. And in the same time, the Borjomi company, they tried to get the investors from France, and Danone was having quite intense negotiations. And then one day we get this leaked letter from Danone, which they sent to the Borjomi company, that they're not able to invest this agreed $2 billion because it was local issues in Georgia. But they more or less has been settled. There is still continuing issue in Turkey because of the new pipeline is coming up, and this time we have even less possibility to monitor what is going there. And then we have what we have in Azerbaijan, who's supposed to be the major winner of this deal because the oil is their resource. But still, if you look, they say that they decrease the poverty. The percentage for education or the healthcare system in the budget does not increase, is the same. Last 2 years, they resettled from the center of the Baku 140,000 of the people who are living in the center of Baku. They renovated the city first for the Eurovision and then the first Olympic European Games. European first, doesn't matter. And it cost $8 billion. And because already this time the oil prices go down and Azeri budget is now a bit deficitic because they never diversify and they have the problems, they have been forcing the state bureaucrats to give part of their salaries as the contribution to this renovation. So the money, and then you have lots of the funds which Aliyev family created, and they, for example, reconstructing the Versal, which is, of course, should be done through the Azeri money, of course. Or there is lots of this kind of project all around the Europe and the world. And on top of that, Aliyev family, they really now so strong that he managed to do the constitutional changes, so now there is no anymore any presidential term in Azeri constitution. He can run and run and run. He will never be getting out. So this is the conflict which is Azeri society right now facing. And the people with whom I work now more than 20 years, and they try to convince me that oil development for Azerbaijan was good thing. Now they say that yes, somebody from OPEC was right when they said the oil is the excrement of Diablo. So they get to that point. So this is most sad story I can say. 80 person is arrested, they have the political prisoner. So everybody who is not agree right now with the official course of the Aliyev, they are arrested. And we have lots of the colleagues who is right now in the prisons.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, as a last question to you before we open the discussion to the audience, I feel urged to ask about reform and alternatives. One of the last chapters of your book, Wars of Plunder, is called Resources for Peace, right? Mm-hmm. That would be a good motto for discussing this topic, and a good motto for our future, hopefully, too. Could you, just in a few points, mm-hmm. say something about possible ways in a more peaceful and sustainable future? What do you suggest?
Yes, big program, time to stretch and reflect. Okay, so first one has to understand that there are lots of actors. It's a commodity that it's very difficult to not get rid of, but to live without. I've participated to many policy initiatives over the past 2-3 decades. So things you can do is generally you start by looking at where the problem is worse. Like, if you've got a conflict oil and it's really financing something very, very nasty, in the case of ISIS, which was a bit of a no-brainer. if you at least don't take the idea that ISIS, they have their own project, and why not try to, you know, pursue it? You intervene militarily with the bombing, etc. So it's not a peaceful way of doing it, but it's a very effective way if you do it properly. And that's what was kind of done to some extent. I'm sorry to have to say it. Yes, sorry to say that. Maybe it's not diplomatic, but... So essentially, it was about bombing the areas. The Russians on their own side tried to disclose all the little deals that ISIS had with Turkish corporate interest. And so once all this stuff is exposed, generally tends to dry up a little bit. And that's what happened, which I think is a good thing when you've got grave human rights abuses committed by a belligerent. Then when you're looking at environmental conflicts, it's something that you can manage without violence. Actually, you should take the violence out of it in the very first place. It's not always easy to do. There are several ways of doing it. The first initiative that was taken in the mid-1990s was the so-called US-UK voluntary principles on security and human rights. So I participated in that, and the idea was to tell oil companies and mining companies, well, look, you're going into those politically sensitive areas, you know you're facing security risk, you're generally gonna be hiring or passing contracts with the local security forces. Those can be police, they can be army units, but you need to do a few things before you hire them, and think about the consequences. The first one is, who are you engaging? Have these people have a bad track record of human rights abuses? Second, do they have proper guidelines? Do they have a discipline behavior? Will they be impugned if they are committing abuses or not? And depending on the list of questions, if it's no, then you need either to hire somebody else or not go in the area in the first place. So that's a little bit like a first step, is to have, as you showed in the case of the pipeline, saying to BP, well, you know, BP, you need to think about it. And BP was part of those discussions. Then after that, the next step is generally for the communities to try to engage with the communities and trying to say, okay, well, you know, what would make you happier? And sometimes they would say, well, it's about school, it's about this, that they can deliver, but often it's about changing the government and changing the, not only at the central level, but also the local elites, who can sometimes be very predatory and play the double game of blaming the companies while at the same time taking the money from the company and exciting local communities. So that is also something one can work on. And then at the more systemic level, it's about trying to transform power relations within society so that we don't see an elite that really feels like they can do anything, that their bodyguards unit can jail people, they can have secret prisons, etc. And in order to stop that, well, essentially, one needs to get sometimes out of the country, but very often it's very difficult to orchestrate. And the second thing is to diversify the economy so that the power relation change, because suddenly oil is not the only game in town. There are many other business sectors out there. Okay, so you know, all these are possible steps. It's a broad range of things. There are many other initiatives that are out there in order to make the government more accountable. Very often it's about being devoted to one particular cause. I know that I've been kind of working, and some of my former colleagues, I've worked on the case of Angola for many, many years. I may have, if there are questions on it, maybe we can come back. But it takes a lot of time because those regimes can be very stable, unfortunately. And resist change for a very long time. And if it's not the same ruling people, the same type of regime will be in place. Mm-hmm. So there may be a coup d'etat, but it'd be more or less reproducing the same patterns.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Maybe you have some more ideas, suggestions on that topic or the others that had been raised during our panel discussion. In good old VIDC tradition, I will open the floor to you, to the audience. We always reserve half of the time
for your questions and statements. You are invited to do both, to make statements or raise questions to our panelists. Feel free to do that in German or English. We have those little machines here, and you put it on if the question is raised in German. So please raise your hands and ask. As I said, it's broad, it is a hot topic, and you may address the whole. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there is one, and there is another one, and a third one.
And
fine.
A fourth one, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And a fourth one, I've seen that. So the first question comes from here. Wait for the mic, please. Mm. Yeah.
You were going to comment on the incoming Trump administration with respect to oil and also, I guess, Rex Tillerson. Could you please come back to that comment that you were going to make?
Yes, okay. I even have a slide for that.
Sorry, Philippe.
Okay. And you hold the questions.
Yeah,
okay.
I collect the questions. So there is the second one. Could you please raise your hand again that we find you? Yeah. And then in the row behind the gentleman with the pink shirt. Yeah.
I want to thank you for the presentations. I had a question in regard to the main narratives. And I think there's a narrative that you didn't mention, or I would suggest that maybe you try and go into, and that's the development conflict narrative, from my understanding. Mm-hmm. Because we have a, there's a clear evidence and research has been done in regard to fossil fuels. Mm-hmm. But you look at the historical development of the Western world, Europe and America, a lot of it was based on fossil fuels. Mm-hmm. Now, you look at developing countries, many countries, for example, in Africa, mm-hmm. They have to use fossil fuels, or the industries are not yet developed as much to mm-hmm. switch to renewable energy mm-hmm. and everything. Mm-hmm. So what would be your alternative? Because even at the COP22, there was still some tension in regard to how much the Western world is going to contribute to help these countries mm-hmm. switch to renewable energy. Mm-hmm. So what could be your alternative in regard to the development state and the way developing countries should go, since renewable energy is not very, it's not affordable for many countries. Thank you.
Thank you very much. What a good question. And the gentleman behind. Yep.
Hello, I'm Pushkal Chaparwal, a graduate of the Diplomatic Academy. First of all, good evening to all of you, and thank you so much, both of you, for this enlightening presentation. I have a question regarding the presentation which we just saw. We talked about the Southern Gas Corridor and the Turk Stream gas pipeline, and this was driven by the European demand of energy. But when we consider the rise of China and the growing consumption patterns of China, which will happen in the future, how do you see China's engagement in that Caucasus area? And also, given Iran, last year we had the JCPOA agreement, and a lot of European companies, especially oil and gas companies, are going to Iran for business, Shell especially. So how do you see Iran and China changing the geopolitics of the region in terms mm-hmm. of energy? Thank you.
Very good, thank you. And the fourth question, yeah. Last row, or nearly last row. And then we come back to you, right?
Mm-hmm. Hello. Thank you for your presentation. I need to mention that I have studied in the oil and gas university and also worked for more than 10 years in the oil and gas. Mm-hmm. And I have seen one slide which was very interesting there, which was stated the amount of energy which results from the fossil sources. Mm-hmm. So to add a little bit on, I mean, it was not even mentioned too much in this presentation, but today more than 60% of the energy worldwide is produced from fossil mm-hmm. sources, correct? Yeah, so mm-hmm. basically we couldn't even eliminate the coal since 200, 300 years ago, mm-hmm. and now we are making the bad guy out of the oil and gas. Mm-hmm. But actually mm-hmm. oil and gas could be even prolific for everyone. Mm-hmm. The problem is the corruption, which I don't know, since the mankind couldn't be eliminated. So what alternatives, like my colleague said, first, yeah, what alternatives, because even in US right now, 58% of the electricity is produced by fossil and coal and oil and gas. So thank you very much.
That's right.
Thank you very much. Very good questions. So you wanted to start already. The first two questions were directed to you. So
Okay.
And please start.
The third one. Okay. So very quickly. So for Trump, I think, you know, it's a bit of a bit of a shock maybe to many people, and they realize, wow, you know, Trump, we didn't expect it, and now we've got Rex Tillerson, CEO of Exxon. Well, yes, it's new, but at the same time, it's not new. Okay. Who was there before Obama? Okay, George W. Bush. Who did he hire as vice president? The CEO of Halliburton, the largest oil service company. So it was a smaller company, but he had a bigger job. So in some ways, it's not unusual. That's what I'm trying to say. Nonetheless, so here is basically the energy team for the Trump administration. We've got four people. We've got Trump, who has clearly stated, even if it's brief, his energy plan, and it's simple, it's America first. So that's going to be, so it's going to be first in trying to become an energy, become again an energy superpower. It's about trying to achieve energy dependence, and it's building up export markets even, and of course, pursuing the interest of American companies abroad. And as part of his team, he has three people. The person will be in charge of the energy sector will be Rick Perry, who's Texas governor. So he's very pro-oil. At the same time, he did not oppose the creation of lots of windmill farms in Texas, so we're still open. But nonetheless, during his own presidential campaign, he said that the energy department, Department of Energy, should be dismantled. So that's one out of the two people there who actually want to dismantle the institution they are given. But that's very classic for corporation. It's about institutional breakdown. If you break down the institutions that regulate you, you can generally profit better. Okay, so there's, again, not much of a surprise there. Rick Tillerson, my sense is that it'll be crucial, of course, in making diplomatic decisions, and that he was picked in part because Trump has a classic and quite traditional view of seeing energy as a major driver of economic success and diplomatic relations, etc. And finally, we've got Scott Pruitt, who is from Oklahoma. So Oklahoma is a little bit like the other two guys who are from Texas. It's an oil state. Huh? It's just neighboring it. And the Attorney General's Pruitt essentially was key in trying to undermine all fracking regulations put forward by the EPA, the Environmental Protection Agency. So he's there essentially to make it easier, even easier, I would say, for fracking to take place. Okay, so that's the team. It's going to have several consequences. First, we don't know, because Trump has been flip-flopping on many issues. But let's say that normally we should expect sanctions toughened up on Iran, so possibly taking up to 1 million barrels off the market. That's more or less the gain that Iran made since the sanctions were first imposed and hardened and then lifted. Second, with China, there's going to be a lot of signposting, including by Rex Tillerson when he was doing his congressional hearing. He had strong words with regard to South China Sea's attitude by the Chinese government, to which the Chinese government, through its public media, responded through basically saying, okay, we're going to prepare for war, since this is what you're going to take. The Foreign Affairs spokesperson even said that we're not going to use gloves. So in diplomatic language, for me, it's very clear. Then with Venezuela, of course, it's a very important supplier to the US. It's second after Canada. And with Venezuela, Exxon has a little debt to settle. It tried to settle it through the International Business Arbitration Mechanism of the World Bank, and he got only 10 cents to the dollar. It was aiming at $16 billion. It got 1.6. So there is still about $14 billion worth of assets to recover from the Venezuelan government. So watch that space, it's going to be quite interesting. And then of course is the relationship with Russia. And there it's much more complicated. I cannot say I'm an expert at all. Obviously, like Total, the French company, and like a number of Western companies, working with Russia offer great advantages. First, it is kind of an open market. You can go and get into projects more easily than in the Middle East in some ways. It has less political risk somehow, except that those political risks can be about the, you know, unintended effects that the sanctions can have. So the US has imposed the hardest sanctions on Russia. The Chinese have no sanctions. The European have sanctions that have been grandfathered, meaning that if you had a project, you don't stop it, you can continue. And the US, you stop everything. So Exxon had to stop everything. The Chinese continued business and expanded new projects. And the Europeans have had to just maintain the projects that they already had. So that is going to change. And then finally, with regard to Trump and climate change in general, of course, well, it's true. I mean, the Chinese, no, I'm kidding. but obviously, this is going to be a factor of tension somehow, because getting to the kind of consensus that we got for Paris was difficult. And really, there was a sense that, okay, we were truly in the 21st century now, not back in the 1950s, but apparently that's not the idea, okay? So we'll see what happened. Okay, so quickly for the second question with regard to development.
Do you have slides for that as well?
Yes, but it would take me a little bit of time to get there. But essentially, the answer, yeah, is that if, for example, the European countries you know, consume less oil and really push for the world to move out of oil, well, the price of oil is going to come down. And that's going to make oil cheaper for developing countries, which is a good thing. And that's a little bit like the idea that I would say. We don't need even to orchestrate that and coordinate that. All we need to do is reduce demand while making sure that, you know, enough oil is being produced where it's necessary. But generally, you'll still have oil available out there at a cheaper price. So from a developmental perspective, it's not bad. And I think that can be done, for example, within the European Union. It has been done somehow. Have, you know, minimum taxations. So we have you know, import excise duties on oil and on fuel oil. So those things can be done more massively. We could, for example, have China increasing taxation on oil. And who knows, maybe even in the US. Well, if those three consumer regions were increasing fuel taxes to a level where it has an effect on demand, then for sure we'd see a depressed oil price. Not everybody could be producing at that price, but there are still quite a bit of a margin. So you could still have lots of oil for poor countries that is relatively affordable. And that would be a good thing from that kind of perspective. Now, mind you, also, you always have to remember that oil is great, but it also does nasty things, including in many developing countries, kill people on roadsides. 1.3 million people die of car accidents. The very, very vast majority of them are pedestrians and cyclists in developing countries.
Thank you. So, the question on China and the region goes to you, but you're also invited to address other subjects, sure. For example, the Trump-Russia connection.
We'll start with China, and I think all of you know that China has lots of the money and they don't know where to put this money. This is a major challenge for China for now. For in the last 2 years, they created you can say three major bank who will do the one is this Asian Infrastructure Bank, where some European governments hold the shares. US does not hold the shares, which from Trump's supporters it comes out that they may consider, but it was because they will restart the war. So I don't know what will happen. And this bank is supposed to invest annually up to 100 billion USD around the globe. Then they have another bank which they create together with Russia, Brazil, India, South Africa, I hope, all with all the BRICS countries. Mm-hmm. And again, that is not that big, but up to 20 billion per year could be expected. And then they have so-called Silk Road Fund, which is considered for around China, and this around China includes the Caucasus and Balkans as one of the priority areas. So it's quite a strange neighborhood, but we are still in neighborhood. So China's involvement till now, this was this first involvement one in this TANAP funding. Mm-hmm. They try a few times to start oil exploration in Caspian, both in Kazakhstan and in Azerbaijan. They have not get into that highest level. They have lots of the problems. But what is interesting here, how China is pushing the projects forward. And here, I think there would be quite some problems in terms that, as you know, while the China's environmental policy is quite strict, it does not mean that it's implemented even in China. So if there is lots of the things which is not written in the country's legislation, and if you consider the neighborhood, which includes the Georgia, Azerbaijan, Armenia, and even Turkey, lots of environmental legislation is very weak. Social legislation is again very weak, so number of things done under the practices, because there is the practice to do the social impact assessment, both in Georgia, Turkey, but it's never written in legislation that it needs to be done. It's simply done because this is the practice, and then the companies are followed it because it has been done somehow with the state support. So in this case, they are quite objectively surprised why they should do something which is not written nowhere. What is the reason for that? So this is the one issue. This China involvement is very soft. They don't try to create any conflicts between the countries. So they are choosing the concrete projects and adding some contributions. So they try to, at least on this stage, to avoid any type of the conflicts that will bring like Azerbaijan or Armenia and somehow to conflict with each other. They are taking small point projects. In case of the Iran, we don't know what will happen, but actually the lifting the sanctions on the Iran really plays the bigger role in the energy sector of the South Caucasus, not in terms of the only oil and gas, but in general energy, because it's the one of the issue which now is very difficult. Along the pipeline, there is also transmission line war starts. So first thing which the Iran proposed to Armenia, Georgia, and Russia, not Azerbaijan, was to create the regional distribution of the electricity market in a way that, from one side, it's not the bad idea. From another side, mm-hmm. Who will depend? What would be the rules? Because if it would be, for example, European Union, it's clear there is a rules written. When there is no rules written, who is doing what? It's not clear. Mm-hmm. And then this for small countries is maybe it's a big problem. So Iran tries to invest, and they have quite good relations with Azerbaijan. I don't know, maybe you recognize, but in the one of the projects for Shah Deniz development, they already get share, and they try to restore now the good relations with Azerbaijan also in the oil development. They have some fights in early 90s, direct fights over this oil reserves, but now they try to really. So about development, I will just want to stress mm-hmm. one thing. My problem, I'm working with the development institutions who are investing to the countries, like third world countries, not for development of their economy, but to extract the resources and bring into in the Western world, let's say that way. And I never saw any project which put and designed that way, really helping people on the ground, and that country's economy are developing. It's not about oil and gas. It doesn't matter what type of the resources we will design that way. It can be solar. You can construct like huge solar somewhere and export it to the European Union from the like desertic, and it would be awful project in a way because it would not really bring anything additional to the people who are living there. So maybe we really need to redesign what is the paradigm in terms of what is, if we are speaking about the these small countries or not that developing countries like Africa or so, Georgia's development, what is really investing of this money, what is really brings for these countries. Okay. And another thing is that, for example, we are not...
Be short on that, please, because we want to have a second round.
So this is about oil. Maybe it's oil glut is happening, gas glut is happening in European Union. But these are the things which is not spoken. It's too technical, maybe from one side, but from another side, it's up to the citizens of this country to understand, do you need that amount of the gas to consume? Do you need that amount of the oil to consume and really pushing for this resources development?
Mm-hmm. This answer addressed already the big question on reform alternatives and a transition to a decarbonized energy system. But how? Mm-hmm. Yeah, we have that on the agenda, don't worry. I just want to invite you to raise hands to have a second round. And I have a look if there is, if there are any hands up. So, okay, so we go back to
there,
Philippe.
There, but
yeah,
I'll
collect,
go first
but
four
we have your okay. question.
Yeah, I'll take
on
that
the
one and then that one after. Yeah.
Hello, thank you for your wonderful discussion panel. But at least I'm a little shocked by hearing the results. I shortly need to introduce myself. I did a bachelor in development studies and currently I do a master in global studies. Additionally, I'm a left-wing political activist, so you can imagine I'm heavily concerned with the climate change. And what I found shocking today evening is that is just told being one of the narratives of the 21st century. I'm convinced it is not one harmless narrative of the 21st century. It is the most important narrative of the 21st century, and we need to act, as by 2020, 200 million human beings will need to escape from their homelands because of the climate change. Mm-hmm. So we need to act now and not in a few years and not slowly. And as I heard today that in Azerbaijan, people are not equally compensated for the land taken by for example, the British Petroleum. I can imagine that one colleague in front of mine asked before for Africa that with renewable energies, we could help those people to work to get a future of high promise and we should escape from our oil work. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Are there more questions or statements? One more?
Mm-hmm.
Feel free to pose it. The mic is coming to you.
Hi. As a petroleum engineering student, we are more from the technical side. Mm-hmm. And you mentioned like electricity in cars, like Tesla. Mm. But I don't think that's a solution because, I mean, what about all the hydrocarbons going into the production of the batteries, mm-hmm. which aren't sustainable at all at the moment?
Yeah.
I mean, it's not like Elon Musk tries to sell it, mm. like with his home batteries and all the stuff. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's so much energy going in there and as well as so much oil going into technology, making cars lighter mm-hmm. with polymers using.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't think that electrical cars are the solution at all at the moment.
Mm-hmm. So mm-hmm. Okay. So the three questions fit very well together.
Yeah.
And I just have, yeah, there's one and two. And then three, okay. And then I close the list. Okay, so we have three more questions. And you have the possibility to answer, give some concluding remarks. I'm very sorry
We have to give them at least 5 minutes to address this huge question of reform alternatives. Okay.
Okay. My question concerns the fact that, first of all, before I ask my question, I think that there's a small concern that I feel like should be addressed, because I feel the whole thing is sort of an oxymoron. You take one part of the same earth to think you're solving a problem, and at the end of the day, you cause one damage on the other side when you think you. So it's, the whole thing is an oxymoron. And is there a space in whatever you are doing in all these numbers to address these kind of issues? That's my first question. And my second question is that in the effort to explore oil from southern states, particularly African states, there's always this narrative of help coming inside. Why does everyone feel the need that there should always be help involved? Mm. If you want to do business, why don't we do business? But the moment there's this kind of dichotomy of South versus North, is no longer business, then the narrative of help comes inside. So these are my two questions.
Okay, thank you. Could you please raise your hands again that we see? Yep, okay. One, two.
Thank you, good evening. I believe it was in one of your slide decks that you had peak demand versus peak oil, because in the past it was mostly peak oil that we were talking about, and I believe it was this year, oh no, last year, that Shell released a statement that they were more talking about peak demand than about peak oil. Mm. Since you didn't really go in depth here, I just wanted to say, how do you view this debate? Mm-hmm. And do you think that this is something that might be more regionally focused? So could peak demand be something that might be real here in the Western world and not so much in China and maybe more emerging and developing countries? And if you view so, when do you think? I mean, of course, you don't have a crystal ball, but if you think so, when do you think this might be possible? Mm-hmm.
Great question. Okay. Thank you. And our last question, the gentleman with the blue pullover. Yeah.
My question is, it belongs also to the environmental part, and it's like you pointed out the five main areas with climate change, etc. Mm-hmm. My question is, can we achieve the Paris goals, or is it unrealistic, and what has to be done to achieve them? Because when we don't do anything, it's like very unrealistic to achieve them. Thanks.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for this short question. So I've shut the speakers list to give them each 5 minutes to conclude and answer to your questions. Thank you very much. Philippe, you want to start?
Yes, okay. And several of the questions are related, so I'll try to articulate it.
Yep.
So first, if you take a realist position on this, meaning essentially go for a progressive status quo, but it's still a status quo, including the habits of consumptions that we have and that we are trying, or that powerful companies are projecting throughout the world. What is the good life? If you are a Chinese bride, you want your husband to have a car. Okay, that's part of the package. Then indeed, we're not gonna move very fast. It seems like it's nearly impossible to get out of fossil fuel. And that is particularly problematic in the sector of transportation, because a carbon capture at tailpipe is extremely complicated. It's not like a coal power plant where maybe the technology at a certain level of price could be engineered and implemented. So it looks like it's very difficult to get out of that. So how can we find solutions? Well, one would be to say simply, well, I went to China in 91 and I remember seeing very few cars. Actually, I checked later on and I realized there was about 100,000 private cars in China at the time. people were still living, they still had maybe a more difficult life, but they certainly had less pollution, etc. And when you go to Holland, I think that is a possibility. That's what I do in my own life when I don't have to come to Vienna, I cycle. I didn't do it this time because it's a little far. But so, you know, more and more people are realizing that a healthy society can be made up of healthier energy use habits. Some of this can be shifting out of, you know, car consumptions, etc. Okay. The electric cars, I think, the electric cars for me, it's a Tesla. I ordered a Tesla Model 3 myself on day 3. I realized only it was day 3. I didn't ask my wife. I said, do you want to buy one? And then I sent a second message saying, I just did. Thank you for saying yes. Of course, but I don't have the means. And I've calculated this hope, this false hope, cost me on average, I think it's going to take 3 years. It's going to cost me roughly the interest rate on 1,000 euros that I can get back. So for 30,000, for 30 euros, I create the kind of dream. And of course, the Tesla is like Apple. It's coming from the very top of the market and it's building the dream down a little bit. But remember, the Apple computer, when it came out, the really innovative one, it was too expensive also. It was $2,500. Now, many of you have iPhones, and the iPhones has been mimicked in very cheap versions. That's the hope that I place in electric cars. We don't need, you know, 4,000-pound Model S car with, like, a battery that propels you at 200 kilometers on a German highway. No, it needs somebody to bring you to the grocery store maybe twice a week, and the rest of the time the car is shared by many other people. I've got a car to go in Vancouver, that's my car, and otherwise I've got my bicycle. Okay, and so the electric car for me is not just the electric car, but the whole system, the whole ecosystem of transportation around it. And it means good public transport, but on all the little branches that go into residential areas, like in the US, where you've got many of them, you need those kind of shared cars, etc. So it's just part of, it's not the solution, obviously, but it's part of the tools that can be used. Second, with regard to peak oil and peak demand, it's very much related to that. I think Europeans have peaked already. OECD oil demand has peaked, in part in the context of high oil prices. But what was very depressing is to see the relationship of low oil prices and consumer habits in the US. Again, we find ourselves in a situation where people are going back to the pickup trucks, the SUVs, and all these types of gas-guzzling vehicles. They have become more fuel efficient, but still. And to be frank, I was pretty disgusted when I saw Volkswagen being sued for $14 billion, knowing, you know, damn well that those big diesel trucks, you're talking of 7.3-liter trucks sometimes, are being manned by a, you know, beefy guy, 35-year-old, alone, driving, you know, in town. And so, you know, it's like double standard. So I think that needs to change. And hopefully we get more activism on the part of Europe to also change that. I think the European Union had a good chance to say, well, this is the model of car we would like you, the US. And who is the guilty one here? It's a little bit more of nitrogen oxide, tricking a little bit the system. Or is it to have you guys have how many, 100 million pickup trucks on the road? Who is the criminal there? I mean, it's obvious to me, okay? So that was not done, and I think it was a missed opportunity, but it's up to people, you know, like in this audience, to just find something to fight for and just orchestrate a little campaign on this. And that's about it, I think. With regard to aid and why this north-south dimensions come in all the time. Well, first, to be frank, sometimes when you're operating in those contexts, you need to be a little bit aware of the impacts. And so the Norwegians, having been praised as managing the oil sector so well, and they did, they sit on $1 trillion sovereign fund at the moment, and my folks in Alberta are on a budget deficit and running out of debt, and they had the same time with the same amount of money, but we don't pay tax in Alberta. That's much better. And that kept the same party in power for 40 years, 4-0. Same party, 40 years.
And then, of course, when the oil dropped, then they changed party. And now they have a left-wing party with no money in the coffers. But anyway, that's for the great Canada. So it's important that we think, okay, we're going to exploit oil in that country, and we're going to try to help the country manage it better. But it's often a pretense. When you look at the Norwegians, they've got this aid for development thing. It's very well funded, about $50 million per year on the, at the peak. They've been working in many places. I've been working a little bit, observing them at least, for example, in South Sudan. Well, it didn't prevent a disaster from happening. And what I didn't like so much is when Rex Tillerson, during his congressional hearing, was interrogated about that, the oil curse, etc., and what he intended to do, given that it's such a problem. And his response was simply, oh, USAID has lots of institutional capacity building, and they'll just do more. So for me, it's very much like a way to push the problem away. And that's where aid is bad. It allows you to say, well, here we are. We've spent $10 million on governance of oil in South Sudan, so it's going to be okay. Well, no, it's not going to be okay, you know. And that's it's a very good effort, but managing oil better in and out of itself is not it's not a solution to the whole governance problems of those countries.
But we had that with the uneven consumption patterns, right? I mean,
yeah,
that was his point. That's how I understand that.
I didn't quite get that question.
We consume what is extracted from there.
Yes, of course, and historically it's been massive. I mean, you look at oil consumption historically in the US. I have not done the figure because I have it up to 65 only, but it's I wouldn't be surprised if it consumed nearly half of the oil that has been produced. So out of the 1.5 trillion barrels of oil that have been burned, a lot of it. Plus, we have to understand that we are living in a petrol culture. You know, a culture that is seeped through oil. And it's not only the highways, etc., that I showed, but it's also like the adulation that we have for cars. So of course in Vienna people understand the adulation we can have for horses. And you know, all these elements of freedom, beauty that comes also with car, like they were coming from horses. The status that you had came in part from how beautiful your horse was and how well you could, you know, ride it, etc. It's true to some extent. And so cars are a little bit the same, and so people identify. But petrol culture is there also in much more insidious ways, in the way BP, for example, tried to be one of the chief sponsors of the Tate Gallery in London. And there was a big pushback saying, well, wait a minute, you're a climate criminal. We don't want you to get a good name by basically showing your nice little logo associated with art, you know? The art should be protected from your greasy fingers, okay? So it's all about thinking, you know, what kind of culture can we come out that is different from the petrol culture we've grown up with for probably four or five generations now?
Okay, thank you, Philippe. On the 9th of February, there starts the Congress for a Good Life at the Vienna Business and Economics University, or Economics and Business University, where we can proceed our discussions on development strategies and a good life for all on this planet. Thank you very much, you two, the panelists. She refused to answer to the question. So
no,
we have do you want to have a... No, you said you don't want to address the reform agenda. And
No. I will just say one thing. The problem starts in the developed countries. Unless the public money, which is going to the south, would not be very transparent and would not really go to help those people, because this is at the end ODA money, and unless our company will be benefiting from this ODA money, rather vice versa, the people living there benefiting, nothing will change. It's a part also of this culture you're speaking. It's historically that way. Noble starts oil exploration, and we're following this pattern. So we really simply need to change our ways how we're asking, and also ask our governments where they're paying their taxpayers' money. I'm living in Georgia, but I'm paying taxes in the European Union, so it's also my taxpayers' money.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you again, you both. And the great audience and your excellent questions that enriched our debate. You are invited to have wine. There is some wine, yeah. Wine and snacks together with our panelists. Mm-hmm. They stay with us and with the colleagues from the VIDC. We will be here and open to further and informal conversation. Thank you for being here.